वर्ड्स आर ब्रिजेस,
शब्द सेतु हैं।
अल्फाज दिलों को और इंसानियत को जोड़ने का एक अजीम और तरीन पुल है।
वाकगल पालंगलान
गुम सिर दलो
लफ्ज जो सरी को दिलदारान
वही न थे
आखर हमार मेल संग आखर हमार जोड़
हक्ते हमार हेतु
कक्थे रोक यखराई से
थुही इनकुम कैना से हम तू अनी
अजरहना आपाती किसले
ग्राउटाइनिंग याउक्राई
शब्द सेतु होन
शब्दां दी सान।
गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन। On behalf of our co-directors, Namita Gokhale and William Dalrymple, producer Sonjoy Roy, and all of us at Teamwork Arts, I welcome you back for another exciting session of Jaipur Literature Festival's Words Are Bridges. As always, through this session, we will take you on multilingual journeys, celebrating the richness and diversity of Indian languages through translations. Our session today is K.R. Meera, The Language of Metaphor. K.R. Meera and Abhirami Girija Sriram in conversation with T.T. Srikumar. K.R. Meera's Suryani Aninja Oru Stri, pulsating with themes of biblical allusions, myth, and martyrdom, brings alive the tale of Jezebel. The novel scrutinizes the micropolitics of contemporary Kerala and confronts the hypocrisy of patriarchal interpretations of myth and history. Editor and translator Abhirami Girija Sriram and her co-translator K.S. Biju Kumar's English rendition of this profound text is to be released next year. In a conversation with T.T. Srikumar, they discuss their process of writing and translating this crucial and transformative work, which brings alive the female voice muted through generations. K.R. Meera is the author of more than a dozen books in Malayalam, including novels, novellas, short story collections, essays, and children's literature. Her novel Arachar, which won the Kendra and the Kerala Sahitya Academy Awards, was translated by J. Devika as the Hangwoman and was shortlisted for the DSC Literary Prize. Her translated works include Yellow is the Color of Longing, The Gospel of Judas, The Poison of Love, The Unseeing Idol of Light, and The Angel's Beauty Spots. Abhirami Girija Sriram is an editor and translator. Having worked in publishing for over a decade, she's particularly interested in literature in translation from Tamil and Malayalam. She translated C. Ayyappan's short story, Branthu, for the Oxford India Anthology of Malayalam Dalit Writing, and is one of the translators of Jarakal, a collection of 23 Malayalam short stories by Dalit writers, edited by M.R. Renu Kumar, published in English as Don't Want Caste. She has co-edited an anthology of personal narratives titled Salt and Pepper and Silver Linings, celebrating our grandmothers. Currently, she is chief sub-editor of Frontline magazine. T.T. Srikumar currently teaches at the Department of Communication, EFL University in Hyderabad. He has previously taught at National University of Singapore and Division of Social Sciences in Hong Kong. He is the author of the book ICTs and Development in India, Perspectives on the Rural Network Society, widely published in national and international journals. He's presented research papers in major communications and social science conferences held in Asia, USA, Europe, and many other countries. A literary critic and columnist in Malayalam, he's written more than 300 articles and has been handling a column titled Fourth Eye in the Madhyamam Daily for the last 7 years. Before we move on to our next session, we request you all to please follow our handles, JLF Lit Fest, on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram to get notified on the upcoming sessions. In case any of you drop off due to bandwidth issues, you can find us on our YouTube channel, Jaipur Lit Fest JLF, and on our Facebook page, JLF Lit Fest. We now present K.R. Meera, The Language of Metaphor.
So let me begin by giving a quick overview of the novel itself, about the protagonist, and also the storyline. This is about a professional, a career-oriented, studious professional who is undergoing a trial in the family court for divorce. And she's being cross-questioned by her spouse's liar. I think the whole frame of the novel is set in this. We find her quite often dumb in the court and inarticulate, but then she speaks loudly to the readers through a chain of memories that she unleashes. This is the strategy of the narrative that Meera has applied in this novel. This takes me back to her earlier work, Aracha, the Hangwoman, where the narrative is slightly different. There are two kinds of differences that I can notice here. One is that the pivotal trope in Hangwoman had been history and state, whereas in this particular novel, the significant trope that she has deployed is basically religion and family. This transition from state and history to religion and family, I think, is what makes a rupture in the otherwise, you know, otherwise the continuity between Hangwoman and particular novel in its feminist perspective. The most important aspect that I thought should be brought in for discussion here is that the protagonist is being represented as a mirror image of Christ. There are a lot of biblical allusions that appear throughout the novel. And the narrative also weaves from Old Testament to New Testament and brings in other historical details to fit in with this fabulous storyline. So what exactly is the plot here? Is the plot about the political history of religion and family? Or is it just how a woman would undergo and respond to familial pressures as she takes up her life in the way she would want it to move? So here, the persistent question that comes to the mind of a reader here is to understand this predicament of the protagonist. What is it that she is trying to, how is it that she is trying to represent herself here? And that, I think, is a very significant question that Meera is asking. The second observation I find here is that although history is not the pivotal aspect of this particular novel, one of the strategies that Meera has deployed in this novel is go back to family history. And if you know the region from where this story is supposed to happen, the family reunion is actually a wonderful kind of organizational endeavor that is posed in order to trace back the family tree. And what I have found is that I have read many of these family histories from this particular region, that is Kottayam. They all trace their origin from St. Thomas and then suddenly come to 18th century or even early 19th century. So there is this lack of history, the absence of history, or the narrative is shrouded in mystery between the period where they believe that St. Thomas had come and then what they really know about their family history. And here is where I think Meera has very strategically looked at the discontinuities in a patriarchal familial setup that we can find in a place like Kottayam. So there is the kind of sense of region that comes in here, and the kind of biblical imagery that considering the protagonist as a mirror image of Christ throughout that happens. And I think Abhirami also can put in some interesting perspective on this here. I mean, because she's going to be the translator of this book. And also the duality that Meera has brought in to the protagonist is in terms of the duality in the mythical history of the prophet called Jezebel, the woman prophet. So I think, there is in its totality, the novel is actually in a very fabulous way, bringing in certain aspects of patriarchy, which are actually coming to our present history from both religion and the way in which family is understood historically. So I suppose that probably Meera can enlighten us more on these two aspects.
Thank you, Dr. T.T. Srihumar. I shall begin with the circumstances in which I started this novel. After finishing The Hangover, I was under great depression. It was kind of taxing a lot because I had tried to live the lives of the women I had portrayed in The Hangover. So I thought I'll try another novel which will help me overcome the depression which The Hangover caused. When I at the same time I wanted to create recreate the kind of atmosphere which I had created in Hangover 2. So I thought this should be at the same time a continuation of what I was trying to say in Hangover. At the same time, it should be different in many ways. So in Sooryane Aninja Oru Stree, or a woman robbed with the sun, as Abhirami has translated the title, I was trying to live or recreate the life of an 82-year-born woman, young woman, who is supposed to be empowered in terms of education, in terms of social privilege, everything. Yet how disempowered she is in her actual life. So I was trying to understand the relation of this young woman who is born in 1982 with the democracy she is living in. So there is the five aspects I was trying to understand in this story was the relation of a woman living in this times, in our times, with the judiciary, with the family, with the democracy, with or the state, and with her own body or her own self. So these were the five aspects which I was trying to explore through the life of Jezebel. And I named that Jezebel for a very specific reason, because as you know, if you read the old Bible, the Old Testament as well as the New Testament, you'll find that Jezebel is one character who is repeated in both, the only one woman character. And again, she's pictured as a harlot. She's pictured as the embodiment of all the evil you can imagine in a woman. But exactly when you look at history, or when you understand her history, actually who she was, she was a prophetess, and she was trying to understand the religion in her own way. So this name Jezebel is very important in this aspect, in this circumstances where you understand the relationship of a woman living in the contemporary times, both religion as well as her own self, as well as family. So this is why I named her Jezebel. As you said earlier, Jezebel is the person who is talking to herself more than to others, because she is trying to understand herself, her body, her place in this democracy, her place in the religious life, her spirituality, everything. And so she might not be a feminist in the quotation, no? How you want to describe a feminist, but she is the one who is trying to evolve. She's an evolved soul. She's an evolved woman. She's trying to understand the real meaning of empowerment, living her own life. So this is what I had in mind when I was writing Jezebel's life. This is exactly the document of the life of the young women of our country who, even after 70 years of independence, do not have a control over their body, their life, their family, their sexual needs, their professional life, everything. So this is what I had in mind. I was writing about Jezebel.
And also in two places, I remember quite well. The male characters, you know, when she invokes the unfreedom that she experiences, within the family, she invokes, the constitution to say that I even, you know, in any private space, I do have my constitutional rights. One of the male characters, I mean, her father-in-law says that constitution is as relevant only outside family. Within the family, you know, I am the state.
My
law will prevail. And in another occasion, also when the character Anne Mary's mother's husband tells Jezebel somewhat in a very similar way, in that in my family, my rule prevails, and not the Indian constitution. So this, the way in which the state, kind of enters our private realm, but at the same time, it actually fails. Negotiate the marginalized, within the framework of a liberal democracy, I suppose is a theme that recurs in your work.
Yeah, actually there is
that as well.
Yeah, actually there is a specific reason for referring to that democratic rights of a woman inside the family. So just at the time of Jezebel was born, a court in India had ruled that bringing democracy, bringing constitutional rights or fundamental rights into the family will be like letting a bull in a crockery shop. So this was in mind, this was in the background of my mind when I was writing this. And it is like, you are talking about democracy, you are talking about fundamental rights, you are talking about women's rights, you are talking about fundamental rights of a citizen, but you are not letting a woman within a family to practice them or to enjoy them or to experience them. So this is what I wanted to argue or wanted to bring attention to.
Yeah, and that is precisely why I think you bring in this rather very interesting metaphor that the body is the cross that a woman wears in her life. I mean, I said that, like Jezebel is a mirror image of Christ throughout. I mean, there are many parallels that you draw from Christ's own, life experience and Jezebel's experience. I mean, she herself endeavors to, draw in that parallel, most of the time. And then it's her brother who tells her, the difference. I mean, the Christ had to bear the cross only up to the hilltop, whereas, you are actually wearing it throughout your life. I mean, so it actually represents the kind of painful negotiations that a woman need to undergo within the, structure of the patriarchal family. And then this mention of the state that she invokes is quickly rejected. I mean, because state has absolutely no relevance in the realm where the family operates, and this is a very anti-historical or counter-historical kind of a position that patriarchy is taking. And I think you have been able to rip open this particular contradiction within civil society. I mean, when it encounters family, then civil society disintegrates, failing to kind of negotiate this deep angst that the marginalized would have within it. And in that sense, it becomes not only the story of a woman, but also it represents the story of all the marginalized in one way or the other. That democracy stops, before they could have a clear access to it.
That's true. And I'm really disturbed, as I had said earlier, even after 70 years of independence, even after 70 years of celebrating our democracy, a woman born and brought up in this country is still has to fight for her body rights, physical rights, to her fundamental rights regarding to her body. Everywhere take a look at anyone you encounter, you see that each one of them is actually fighting for the basic rights, the fundamental rights, the bare minimum rights of a human being regarding the body and the sexual needs and their sexuality. And this is why I wanted to bring in the character, biblical character of Jezebel, to say something which I have in mind. about the kind of crisis the body is bringing to human being living in this country, any human being for this matter. Even a man living in this country in the present setup of patriarchy is kind of a victim, is as an equal victim of the system, and we have to write about it, we have to talk about it more and more to bring some light to in the hearts of the people who are operating, who are trying to preserve the same system as it is. So this is what I have in mind while writing about Jezebel and the people, the people who come into her life. They are also fighting with their bodies. In fact, the first fight of a human being, an Indian, any Indian will be with his or her own body. And this is really disturbing.
And then please.
Yeah, this is as you said, when you look at the fight or the struggle of a person to overcome or to tame his or her own bodies, you naturally come into the simile of Christ crucified on a cross. But here the cross is her body itself.
And as a corollary to it, you have also brought up the question of queer politics into it. Because some of the characters, including her spouse, belongs to that community at large, but do not have the courage to face that reality. And I find that the way in which the whole issue of queering is mediated in the novel is a little ambivalent, about how feminism can confront this reality. In fact, theoretically, yes, the feminist politics have been at the international level as well able to integrate well with the politics of LGBT communities. But at the same time, in the novel, we see that this is being portrayed as a hesitant, ambivalent one.
It's not hesitant. In fact, it was kind of realistic. I'll term it as realistic. So even a 1982 born female in this country is confused about how to deal with the queer or transgender or even the sexual minorities of this country. So this is what I wanted to reflect in my novel. This is like a writer would not be having a solution for all the problems she or he is facing. You can first your primary attention will be to shed light on that problem, to understand the problem, to tell the world or tell the readers that there is a problem, and then there will be a combined effort to address it in our own way, from our own experiences. And this is how I have addressed that problem. It's not like a hesitant, I won't agree with that. But I'll say that I was trying to be realistic, to be truthful, to the way other people or people of our times are addressing it.
If I may,
another crucial. I'll come to that actually. I mean, like another crucial question. I mean, Hand Woman has been a pan-Indian novel, so its language has been very different. Now this novel is kind of going to be translated, and the language is actually the language of the region where the novel is anchored. So I suppose to these political questions as well as the difficulties and challenges of translating this novel, I think Virami can actually enlighten us much more on that.
Yeah, sure. I wanted to step in to add to Meera's point about the realistic portrayal of the very natural confusions we have in negotiating with the other. But towards the end of the novel, there is so much empathy. There is a realization that we are all victims, that we are all suffering. And that the human body is a cross not only for the woman, not only for Jezebel, but also for Jerome, and also for Avinash, his partner. So somewhere I think it evens out. She takes us through crests and troughs of the narrative to ultimately reach a space of empathy, which I thought was very beautifully done. When you realize that everybody is, in fact, suffering, everybody who dares to go against the grain, who dares to challenge patriarchy, who steps outside those watertight definitions prescribed by society, has to, in effect, you're on your own, and you bear your cross, and you ascend the Golgotha of life that way. So I must, as regards the translation, I must begin with a disclaimer. I'm not the only translator of this text. And another disclaimer that I'm not a native Malayalam speaker. This translation is a labor of love and collaboration. I'm doing it with my partner, Biju Kumar, who is the bona fide Malayali in the family. I like to call Malayalam my mother-in-law tongue, as opposed to Tamil, my mother tongue. Malayalam is something that I learned literally as a labor of love over the years. So it's been a wonderful window on the world, especially K.R. Meera's very searing, very specific idiom. I've read her works only in translation. Suryane Aninyorastri is the first book I have very closely read in Malayalam. I read it like a poem, one sentence at a time, painstakingly putting one syllable after the other. And it's been a very enriching experience to try and match the searing quality of her Malayalam in English. Of course, I have no illusions about accurate translation or exact correspondence, because that is an anomaly. One can only try to, aspire to the level of her exact and exacting Malayalam. I've heard this being said about her Malayalam, that kanalu pole pollikkunna vaakkukal. So, live coals, embers of words. So that is the sense that Biju, my partner, who's the co-translator, and, he provides the scaffold and I fill in the silences, so to speak. And we've worked very microscopically, it's been in many ways a treasure hunt, because it's so full of biblical allusions, like cracking a crossword puzzle. So much of it is so dense and cryptic, the Malayalam, so lyrical, so pregnant with meaning, and so compressed, the language. So we've tried to recreate the music and the rhythm of the Malayalam to the extent possible. But I think the biblical allusions have made our job a lot more easier. The fact that it's all so perfectly laid out, that the metaphors are so exact, and that, this mirroring of the Christ figure, that it is ambiguous. It starts with Jezebel having a revelation. So in that sense, it makes the translator's job so much easier. And this novel is nothing if not for its metaphors. It comes together because of its metaphors. And I wanted to say that even through the narrative, Destiny speaks to Jezebel in a series of metaphors, in a series of what she calls adayalangal, in a series of signs. So it's sort of woven into the narrative, so to speak. And you have this mythical figure of Jezebel, a very powerful political figure, a prophetess who dared to challenge Prophet Elijah, in the background, against this very, if one may say, realistic and in in many ways a girl brought up in a very sheltered upbringing, somebody who has to undergo the trial of fire that life is in order to learn to resist, in order to understand her own self. So this juxtaposition is so wonderfully done. And yes, the language, it's not only the biblical allusions, it's also very rooted references to, say, the sainted one, Saint Alphonsa. So you know it's Kottayam. You know the context. And the way to Jezebel's home is through the way to the sainted one's place. So there again you have a signpost, literally a translatory signpost that sort of fixes the narrative. The figure of the good woman, the sacrificial, the paragon of sacrifice, the ideal woman that we all aspire to, and this very interesting trope of the one who pretends to be someone she's not, which is nothing short of heresy. Hypocrisy is heresy, said Christ. But you see the daily reality, the daily lived reality of women who keep trying to suppress desire, sexuality, their ambitions in order to try and maintain the status quo. So in many ways, this novel is a scream against the status quo. And that is one reason why it needs to reach a much wider readership. And I think the biblical allusions sort of will, they're already universal. They're so rooted in the specificity of the Kerala Christian landscape, but they will immediately reach out to a non-Malayali readership as well because of the universality of the biblical allusions.
Actually, there are two kinds of challenges, I suppose, a translator would face, in a particular novel. One is obviously, how to translate these biblical allusions. As you rightly said, they are so regionally rooted and explained in a way that, immediately becomes, understandable to the people who live in the region and the locality. Right. But on the other hand, there is also this local language that is very creatively, kind of grafted onto it. If you look at the court trial, for example, the lawyer of her spouse is actually using the local language with all its nuances. And that has a specific role in framing the trial itself in the court.
Right.
The sarcasm, that comes from him is basically, crafted through the stylistic, versions of the language that is being used in the locality. And this is actually a very, very a prominent, challenge. Another thing is to understand the transition of the character herself. Yes. Like, for example, towards the end of the novel, that old priest gives a very, very insightful observation. He says that, invoking, for example, Sartre's Age of Reason, he actually mentions that she has come off, you have to actually come off, and then only you realize what you are. And he says that Christ, for example, came off age, and at that point, there were listeners to him. And that was the point where, people were angry with him, people were affectionate with him, people were starting to understand what he's trying to say, and people were becoming antagonistic to him. So there is a particular age of reason, that you reach, and which, she has actually, not in a very direct way, but in an indirect way, that has brought in. But I think that actually has to be considered in portraying the self-reflection of the character of the novel, and which has a bearing on the way in which we, represent in another language, the self-reflexive, responses of the protagonist.
It is a challenge, and the very economy of her language is a challenge in translation. But we have tried to the extent possible to try and reproduce the registers of the language by incorporating a little bit of the Malayalam. There's this very delightful non-conformist character of the Vellimachi, the grandmother who's a strong, free-spirited character, placed in juxtaposition with Jezebel's uncertainty, confusion, desire to conform, desire to, because the whole proposal of marriage comes as a bolt from the blue, with its baggage of portents and signs and metaphors that she later regrets not having decoded. The price she pays for going with the flow, so to speak. Forget the biblical allusions, even the way Meera describes the sun and the sky, how she creates the atmospherics in a scene, can have a chilling dystopian effect. Hopefully when I read, I'll read that part. So there's no way you can miss any portents. It's all laid out very perfectly, and there is no ambivalence there at all. So half our work is done. The rest is to just match up to that economy, match up to the searing power of the Malayalam to the extent possible in English. And it's been a very enriching, we're only, it's still a work in progress, but it's been an education. So I am looking forward to, it is a coming of age in every sense. This novel is a Bildungsroman of Jezebel. I've heard Meera speak about how she came across the word Jezebel, how she came across a piece of writing called The Jezebel Effect, and the horrendous resonances that the name Jezebel has. She's the archetypal wicked woman of the Bible, who will bring every family to rack and ruin. So to overturn that stereotype is a remarkable, but it doesn't just stop with the name. This itself is a book of revelations. The novel itself is a series of revelations, and everything seems to have been like in a jigsaw puzzle. Everything seems just rightly placed. It is a gospel according to John in a certain sense. It's Jezebel's father is John. And so many little things, they're little pleasures for the translator to discover as one, which is why I called it a treasure hunt and a jigsaw puzzle. So
and what she has hidden in the metaphors and tropes, it's actually a message, which is that every woman would look like a loser, but she is actually a winner. I think has come out very strongly in this, so I suppose, your able translation would really help us to understand this particular message that the provides us, that you may think that the woman is losing, but she's actually winning. At every juncture, you can see this particular aspect that is being kind of foregrounded by Meera, and in a very, very mysterious way. I mean, not directly, but very indirectly.
Life and Meera have both not given Jezebel a choice. She has to come out of her comfort zone and face her trials and reach that fitting conclusion where she becomes the woman adorned with the sun. I think Meera prefers adorned with the sun to robed with the sun. So since it's a work in progress, we will consider that. Yes. So
That is one
Malayalam and the English.
Yes.
First
yes,
Malayalam and then the English.
Sure.
Other way. I mean, yes. How do you want it? First the Malayalam.
May I?
Sure. Sure.
Yes.
Please.
The title, actually I gave it. It's a quote from the Malayalam Bible itself. Suryane aninya oru stree. So aninya can be adorned or robed or clothed or even wore, anything. So I was looking forward to how it will be translated, because the woman is literally kind of adorned with the sun, or being one with the sun. And that's why I had used a lot of metaphors relating to sun in the novel.
Yes. Yes.
And there is one trap for any translator who is attempting to translate this novel, because I have created some of my own biblical metaphors. So it's not in the Bible. I have that's a trap for the translator. So this is a very sadistic author trying to test a translator to trying to translators in this case. Both Biju and Abhirami will curse me sometimes if they look for the equivalent of certain words I have used in the original Bible, but they were mine. Some phrases, some usages. Altogether, it was kind of a revelation for myself too, as an author. You say that, many writers say that when you write something, you are not creating a novel or a story, but you are being created by the story or the novel as a person, as a spirit. So this was kind of a revelation, book of revelation for me too, because as I was delving into it, as I was delving into the life of Jezebel, I could find a lot more about myself. So how I had treated with my fundamental rights, with I had the relation with my fundamental rights, my democratic rights, as well as my physical rights or real rights. So in that way, I think this is a story akin to Arachar. It is kind of a next step to Chetana, the next life of Chetana, but in a different world, in a different place. And that is how this book is important to me. And I would say that Abhirami and Biju have beautifully captured my sarcastic tone in their translation.
Could you please read a portion from the novel so that we can have a...
Maybe Abhi can read. No?
From Abhirami can. Yeah.
Shall I read the first chapter, yeah. Chechi?
Yes, please.
So before I start, I would like to acknowledge that, in fact, she has been, what she set as a trap is actually a triumph of her language and how much she has ventriloquized the Bible and absorbed and imbibed the Bible, so to speak. So, yes, we look forward to meeting that challenge and taking it as seriously as the Bible, because the language is as rich. So, yes, we do look forward to that. And let me start with chapter one. As she stood in the family court, pelted with the blame of having paid a contract killer to murder her husband, Jezebel had a revelation. To endure extreme torture, imagine yourself as Christ on the cross. As you stand in the courtroom in this half-unfinished building, consider the heaviness weighing your chest down as that of the wooden cross. As the short, stout defendant lawyer begins his cross-examination, imagine you're climbing the Golgotha bearing that cross. Count the barbs, both direct and indirect, in those questions as lashings of the whip. Each time the soul is put to death, recognize it will resurrect on the third day and that there will be no pain thereafter. The family court was a building that would forever remain unfinished. On one side of the road stood the church. Their lives were united. On the other side, the court. Their lives were separated. Past the yard of the primary health center stood the steps that led down to the court. They had no handrails. The very first time she walked down those steps, holding on to Velimachi, Jezebel turned into a prophetess who foresaw someone's end. She saw in front of her eyes a body tumble down from above. She saw it crash into the little tea shop at one end of the court's veranda. She saw it shatter the candy jars into smithereens. Wasn't that how Jezebel, the queen of Jezreel, had been thrown down from her palace window? What would become of the human body after such a fall? The spine would crack. The aorta, which carries blood from the heart, would sever. The neck would break. The flow of blood to the brain would cease. He or she would die or live as good as dead. That fall could well have been a sign. Just as Jesus Christ spoke to his followers in parables, destiny had spoken to Jezebel through signs. She would forever regret not paying heed to a crucial sign that had appeared in her life 7 years ago. 7 years ago, on June 16th, she was then a student in her second year of MD, with classes by day and hospital duty by night. An 8-year-old with burns had been rushed into emergency that morning. Smoke lingered in a haze along the corridor through which the gurney carrying him had been wheeled in. As she sped home on her scooter, meaning to return to college to attend the 8:30 morning class, she saw the sky lying face down, dark and bloated, as if it had drowned in the heavy downpour of the past few days. The lightless sun showed up like the protruding eyeball of the brain dead. She sensed an uneasy chill wrap itself around her. As she turned left at the signboard that read, "The way to the birthplace of the saint," her house and the unsightly green Indica parked in front came into view. Even as she parked her scooter next to the car and picked up the bag with her stethoscope and white coat, not pausing to straighten the dupatta slung across her shoulder, she could hear Sosha auntie plead, "If John Sir too forsakes us, we will have no option but death." Inside, her chachan, Kurishimotil Pundotatil Yohannan's son John, sat in his easy chair, spectacles in hand, lost in thought. Leaning against the door and looking on eagerly, one end of her blue-dotted brown cotton sari tucked into her waist stood her ammachi, Ponpalli Varembal Peter's daughter Sara. Rambling non-stop, dressed in a shiny orange Chinese silk sari, embroidered at the hem, and a blouse of the same material, her sparse hair pulled into a tight top knot, was Shosha aunty, a distant relative whom Velimachi liked to describe as the seed of a great-grandfather who had taught Ausepu Kathanar the priest the ploy of making it seem that the northeastern boundary of his own village fell to the west of the then marketplace in order to fulfill a whim of building another church right next to the big church at a time when the rule allowed only one church, a village. Shoshanti's husband, Monichin uncle, who wore a yellow striped t-shirt and pants that could have been less tight and a little longer, sat fiddling with his teacup. "Ah, here she is," exclaimed Amachi when she saw Jezebel. Chachan seemed ill at ease. Amachi muttered, loud enough for Jezebel to hear, "Only if we start looking now, will we find a suitable boy by the time her studies are over?" "Sara is right," chimed in Shosha auntie. "Go ahead with her only if Jezebel and both of you like the boy, Sara. Let him come and see her first, I say," she beseeched again. The proposal of marriage had originally been for Shosha auntie's daughter, Teresa. He was a doctor, born and brought up in another city, an MBBS, MD pathology. A relative of Shosha auntie's had visited his house and fixed the date for the girl seeing. They were on their way. But that morning, Teresa was nowhere to be seen. When the boy's family arrived after traveling all that distance, there had to be a girl for them to see, didn't there? Shosha auntie implored, "John sir, you have to help us. To be honest with you, this alliance suits Jezebel more than Teresa." Having had his tea and biscuits, Monichan uncle wiped his mouth and enjoined with welled up eyes, "I am ready to fall at your feet, John sir." Chachan gave in. "Don't go for your classes today, Mole," he told Jezebel. Jezebel felt within herself the silence described in the Book of Revelations, the silence that spread in the earth and sky when the seventh seal was broken. She walked past the hall with the dining table at one end, the television at the other, and the cane sofa set against the wall to her room, set her bag down on the table and sat on her cot. Felt her body smolder, then chill, fretted that that chill was not the cool thrill that a young Catholic woman ought to have felt upon hearing about her marriage, worried about Laila ma'am's 8:30 class, reasoned that anyway, someday marriage was inevitable, hoped that the one coming was a good man, imagined him to be like John Galt of Atlas Shrugged or Howard Roark of Fountainhead. "Why the glum face, D? Have someone in mind, do you?" Amachi walked in, glaring. "If only," rude Jezebel. She had yet to meet someone who made her feel that she couldn't live without him. A few had admired her in secret. A few others had openly expressed their feelings. Sometimes she had set her heart on some. Sometimes in the company of some others, her heart had come into bud. But once she headed home on her scooter, humming a tune and sat down to study, having shared the day's news with Abel and her Chachan, all thoughts of men vanished from her heart like wisps of cotton in the wind.
Yeah, I think that captures the, you know, kind of the spirit of the language metaphors that Mira has deployed. I mean, I don't think there is anything that is lost out in this translation. It's come out well, you know. I want Mira's reflection also for on that. In that.
Yeah, this is. Shall I read a few lines from the original to understand? ഭർത്താവിനെ കൊലപ്പെടുത്താൻ വാടക കുണ്ടയ്ക്ക് പണം കൊടുത്തവൾ എന്ന് കല്ലറിയപ്പെട്ട് കുടുംബ കോടതിയിൽ നിൽക്കെ ജസബലിന് വെളിപ്പെട്ടത് ക്രൂര പീഡാനുഭവങ്ങൾ മറികടക്കാൻ സ്വയം ക്രിസ്തുവായി സങ്കല്പിച്ചാൽ മതി. പകുതി പണിതീരാത്ത കെട്ടിടത്തിലെ കോടതി മുറിയിൽ നിൽക്കുമ്പോൾ നെഞ്ചിൽ തൂങ്ങുന്ന ഭാരം മരക്കുരിശിൻ്റെതാണെന്ന് കരുതുക. ഉയരം കുറഞ്ഞ് തടിച്ച എതിർവക്കിൽ ചോദ്യം ചോദിച്ചു തുടങ്ങുമ്പോൾ കുരിശുമായി ഗോൽഗോഥ കയറുകയാണ് എന്ന് സങ്കല്പിക്കുക. ചോദ്യങ്ങളിലെ പ്രത്യക്ഷമായും പരോക്ഷമായുമുള്ള അധിക്ഷേപങ്ങൾ ചാട്ടവാറടിയായി കണക്കാക്കുക. ഓരോ തവണ ആത്മാവ് കൊല്ലപ്പെടുമ്പോഴും മൂന്നാം ദിവസം ഉയർത്തെഴുന്നേൽക്കുമെന്നും പിന്നെ വേദനയില്ലെന്നും തിരിച്ചറിയുക. സോ ഐ ഡോണ്ട് വാണ്ട് ടു റീഡ് ദ ഹോൾ ചാപ്റ്റർ ബിക്കോസ് അഭിരാമി ഹാസ് റെഡ് അബൌട്ട് ഹാഫ് ഓഫ് ദ ചാപ്റ്റർ. And I should thank Abhi and Biju for brilliantly capturing the rhythm of what I have written. I don't have enough words to thank them.
Thank you, K.R. Mira, Abhirami, and Mr. Sri Kumar for that wonderful session. Thank you for your brilliant insights into the craft of translation. If you all have enjoyed our session, please do share with your friends and on your social media pages. Thank you all so much for watching and being such a great audience. We promise to be back next week for another exciting session of Words Are Bridges. Have a lovely evening. Good night.